In a Hollow of the Hills. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 5. Chapter 2. Key's attention was presently directed to something more important to his present purpose. The keen wind which he had faced in mounting the grade had changed, and was now blowing at his back. His experience of forest fires had already taught him that this was too often only the cold air rushing in to fill the vacuum made by the conflagration, and it needed not his sensation of an acrid smarting in his eyes, and an unaccountable dryness in the air which he was now facing, to convince him that the fire was approaching him. It had evidently traveled faster than he had expected, or had diverged from its course. He was disappointed, not because it would oblige him to take another route to Skinner's, as Collinson had suggested, but for a very different reason. Ever since his vision of the preceding night, he had resolved to revisit the hollow and discover the mystery. He had kept his purpose a secret partly because he wished to avoid the jesting remarks of his companions, but particularly because he wished to go alone, from a very singular impression that although they had witnessed the incident he had really seen more than they did. To this was also added the haunting fear he had felt during the night that this mysterious habitation and its occupants were in the track of the conflagration. He had not dared to dwell upon it openly on account of Uncle Dick's evident responsibility for the origin of the fire. He appeased his conscience with the reflection that the inmates of the dwelling no doubt had ample warning in time to escape. But still, he and his companions ought to have stopped to help them, and then but here he paused, conscious of another reason he could scarcely voice then, or even now. Preble Key had not passed the age of romance, but like other romancists he thought he had evaded it by treating it practically. Meantime he had reached the fork where the trail diverged to the right, and he must take that direction if he wished to make a detour of the burning woods to reach Skinner's. His momentary indecision communicated itself to his horse, who halted. Recalled to himself, he looked down mechanically, when his attention was attracted by an unfamiliar object lying in the dust of the trail. It was a small slipper, so small that at first he thought it must have belonged to some child. He dismounted and picked it up. It was worn and shaped to the foot. It could not have lain there long, for it was not filled nor discolored by the wind-blown dust of the trail, as all other adjacent objects were. If it had been dropped by a passing traveler, that traveler must have passed Collinson's, going or coming, within the last 12 hours. It was scarcely possible that the shoe could have dropped from the foot without the wearer's knowing it, and it must have been dropped in an urgent flight, or it would have been recovered. Thus practically Key treated his romance. And having done so, he instantly wheeled his horse and plunged into the road in the direction of the fire. But he was surprised after 20 minutes riding to find that the course of the fire had evidently changed. It was growing clearer before him. The dry heat seemed to come more from the right, in the direction of the detour he should have taken to Skinner's. This seemed almost providential, and in keeping with his practical treatment of his romance, as was also the fact that in all probability the fire had not yet visited the little hollow which he intended to explore. He knew he was nearing it now. The locality had been strongly impressed upon him even in the darkness of the previous evening. He had passed the rocky ledge, his horse's hoofs no longer rang out clearly, slowly and perceptibly they grew deadened in the springy mosses, and were finally lost in the netted grasses and tangled vines that indicated the vicinity of the densely wooded hollow. Here were already some of the wider spaced vanguards of that wood, but here, too, a peculiar circumstance struck him. He was already descending the slight declivity, but the distance, instead of deepening in leafy shadow, was actually growing lighter. Here were the outskirting sentinels of the wood, but the wood itself was gone. He spurred his horse through the tall arch between the opened columns, and pulled up in amazement. The wood, indeed, was gone, and the whole hollow filled with the already black and dead stumps of the utterly consumed forest. More than that, from the indications before him, the catastrophe must have almost immediately followed his retreat from the hollow on the preceding night. It was evident that the fire had leaped the intervening shoulder of the spur in one of the unaccountable, but by no means rare, phenomena of this kind of disaster. The circling heights around were yet untouched, only the hollow, and the ledge of rock against which they had blundered with their horses when they were seeking the mysterious window in last evening's darkness, were calcined and destroyed. He dismounted and climbed the ledge, still warm from the spent fire. A large mass of grayish outcrop had evidently been the focus of the furnace blast of heat which must have raged for hours in this spot. He was skirting its crumbling debris when he started suddenly at a discovery which made everything else fade into utter insignificance. Before him, in a slight depression formed by a fault or lapse in the upheaved strata, lay the charred and incinerated remains of a dwelling house leveled to the earth. Originally half hidden by a natural abatis of growing myrtle and ceanothus which covered this counterscarp of rock towards the trail, it must have stood within 100 feet of them during their halt. Even in its utter and complete obliteration by the furious furnace blast that had swept across it, there was still to be seen an unmistakable ground plan and outline of a four-roomed house. While everything that was combustible had succumbed to that intense heat, there was still enough half-fused and warped metal, fractured iron plate, and twisted and broken bars to indicate the kitchen and tool shed. Very little had, evidently, been taken away. The house and its contents were consumed where they stood. With a feeling of horror and desperation, Key at last ventured to disturb two or three of the blackened heaps that lay before him. But they were only vestiges of clothing, bedding, and crockery. There was no human trace that he could detect. Nor was there any suggestion of the original condition and quality of the house, except its size, whether the ordinary unsightly cabin of frontier partners, or some sylvan cottage. There was nothing left but the usual ignoble and unsavory ruins of burnt-out human habitation. And yet its very existence was a mystery. It had been unknown at Collinson's, its nearest neighbor, and it was presumable that it was equally unknown at Skinner's. Neither he nor his companions had detected it in their first journey by day through the hollow, and only the telltale window at night had been a hint of what was even then so successfully concealed that they could not discover it when they had blundered against its rock foundation. For concealed it certainly was, and intentionally so. But for what purpose? He gave his romance full play for a few minutes with this question. Some recluse, preferring the absolute simplicity of nature, or perhaps wearied with the artificialities of society, had secluded himself here with the company of his only daughter. Proficient as a pathfinder, he had easily discovered some other way of provisioning his house from the settlements than by the ordinary trails past Collinson's or Skinner's, which would have betrayed his vicinity. But recluses are not usually accompanied by young daughters, whose relations with the world, not being as antagonistic, would make them uncertain companions. Why not a wife? His presumption of the extreme youth of the face he had seen at the window was after all only based upon the slipper he had found. And if a wife, whose absolute acceptance of such confined seclusion might be equally uncertain, why not somebody else's wife? Here was a reason for concealment, and the end of an episode, not unknown even in the wilderness. And here was the work of the nemesis who had overtaken them in their guilty contentment. The story, even to its moral, was complete. And yet it did not entirely satisfy him, so superior is the absolutely unknown to the most elaborate theory. His attention had been once or twice drawn towards the crumbling wall of outcrop, which during the conflagration must have felt the full force of the fiery blast that had swept through the hollow and spent its fury upon it. It bore evidence of the intense heat in cracked fissures and the crumbling debris that lay at its feet. Key picked up some of the still warm fragments, and was not surprised that they easily broke in a gritty, grayish powder in his hands. In spite of his preoccupation with the human interest, the instinct of the prospector was still strong upon him, and he almost mechanically put some of the pieces in his pockets. Then, after another careful survey of the locality for any further record of its vanished tenants, he returned to his horse. Here he took from his saddle bags, half listlessly, a precious phial encased in wood, and, opening it, poured into another thick glass vessel part of a smoking fluid. He then crumbled some of the calcined fragments into the glass, and watched the ebullition that followed with mechanical gravity. When it had almost ceased, he drained off the contents into another glass, which he set down, and then proceeded to pour some water from his drinking flask into the ordinary tin cup which formed part of his culinary traveling kit. Into this he put 3 or 4 pinches of salt from his provision store. Then dipping his fingers into the salt and water, he allowed a drop to fall into the glass. A white cloud instantly gathered in the colorless fluid, and then fell in a fine film to the bottom of the glass. Key's eyes concentrated suddenly, the listless look left his face. His fingers trembled lightly as he again let the salt water fall into the solution, with exactly the same result. Again and again he repeated it, until the bottom of the glass was quite gray with the fallen precipitate. And his own face grew as gray. His hand trembled no longer as he carefully poured off the solution so as not to disturb the precipitate at the bottom. Then he drew out his knife, scooped a little of the gray sediment upon its point, and emptying his tin cup, turned it upside down upon his knee, placed the sediment upon it, and began to spread it over the dull surface of its bottom with his knife. He had intended to rub it briskly with his knife blade. But in the very action of spreading it, the first stroke of his knife left upon the sediment and the cup the luminous streak of burnished silver. He stood up and drew a long breath to still the beatings of his heart. Then he rapidly reclimbed the rock, and passed over the ruins again, this time plunging hurriedly through, and kicking aside the charred heaps without a thought of what they had contained. Key was not an unfeeling man, he was not an unrefined one, he was a gentleman by instinct, and had an intuitive sympathy for others, but in that instant his whole mind was concentrated upon the calcined outcrop. And his first impulse was to see if it bore any evidence of previous examination, prospecting, or working by its suddenly evicted neighbors and owners. There was none. They had evidently not known it. Nor was there any reason to suppose that they would ever return to their hidden home, now devastated and laid bare to the open sunlight and open trail. They were already far away, their guilty personal secret would keep them from revisiting it. An immense feeling of relief came over the soul of this moral romancer, a momentary recognition of the Most High in this perfect poetical retribution. He ran back quickly to his saddlebags, drew out 1 or 2 carefully written, formal notices of preemption and claim, which he and his former companions had carried in their brief partnership, erased their signatures and left only his own name, with another grateful sense of divine interference, as he thought of them speeding far away in the distance, and returned to the ruins. With unconscious irony, he selected a charred post from the embers, stuck it in the ground a few feet from the debris of outcrop, and finally affixed his notice. Then, with a conscientiousness born possibly of his new religious convictions, he dislodged with his pickaxe enough of the brittle outcrop to constitute that presumption of actual work upon the claim which was legally required for its maintenance, and returned to his horse. In replacing his things in his saddlebags he came upon the slipper, and for an instant so complete was his preoccupation in his later discovery, that he was about to throw it away as useless impedimenta, until it occurred to him, albeit vaguely, that it might be of service to him in its connection with that discovery, in the way of refuting possible false claimants. He was not aware of any faithlessness to his momentary romance, any more than he was conscious of any disloyalty to his old companions, in his gratification that his good fortune had come to him alone. This singular selection was a common experience of prospecting. And there was something about the magnitude of his discovery that seemed to point to an individual achievement. He had made a rough calculation of the richness of the lode from the quantity of precipitate in his rude experiment, he had estimated its length, breadth, and thickness from his slight knowledge of geology and the theories then ripe, and the yield would be colossal. Of course, he would require capital to work it, he would have to let in others to his scheme and his prosperity, but the control of it would always be his own. Then he suddenly started as he had never in his life before started at the foot of man. For there was a footfall in the charred brush, and not 20 yards from him stood Collinson, who had just dismounted from a mule. The blood rushed to Key's pale face. "Prospectin' agent," said the proprietor of the mill, with his weary smile. "No," said Key quickly, "only straightening my pack." The blood deepened in his cheek at his instinctive lie. Had he carefully thought it out before, he would have welcomed Collinson, and told him all. But now a quick, uneasy suspicion flashed upon him. Perhaps his late host had lied, and knew of the existence of the hidden house. Perhaps he had spoken of some silvery rock the night before he even knew something of the lode itself. He turned upon him with an aggressive face. But Collinson's next words dissipated the thought. "I'm glad I found ye, anyhow," he said. "Ye see, arter you left, I saw ye turn off the trail and make for the burning woods instead o' goin' round. I says to myself, that fellow is making straight for Skinner's. He's sorter worried about me and that empty pork barrel. I hadn't oughter spoke that away afore you boys, anyhow, and he's talking risks to help me. So I reckoned I'd throw my leg over Jenny here, and look arter ye and go over to Skinner's myself and vote." "Certainly," said Key with cheerful alacrity, "and the one thought of getting Collinson away, we'll go together, and we'll see that that pork barrel is filled." He glowed quite honestly with this sudden idea of remembering Collinson through his good fortune. "Let's get on quickly, for we may find the fire between us on the outer trail." He hastily mounted his horse. "Then you didn't take this as a short cut," said Collinson, with dull perseverance in his idea. "Why not? It looks all clear ahead." "Yes," said Key hurriedly, "but it's been only a leap of the fire. It's still raging round the bend. We must go back to the cross trail." His face was still flushing with his very equivocating, and his anxiety to get his companion away. Only a few steps further might bring Collinson before the ruins and the notice, and that discovery must not be made by him until Key's plans were perfected. A sudden aversion to the man he had a moment before wished to reward began to take possession of him. "Come on," he added almost roughly. But to his surprise, Collinson yielded with his usual grim patience, and even a slight look of sympathy with his friend's annoyance. "I reckon you're right, and mebbe you're in a hurry to get to Skinner's all along o' my business. I oughtn't have told you boys what I did." As they rode rapidly away, he took occasion to add, when Key had reined in slightly, with a feeling of relief at being out of the hollow, "I was thinking, too, of what you'd asked about anyone living here unbeknownst to me." "Well," said Key, with a new nervousness. "Well, I only had an idea o' proposing that you and me just took a look around that holler war you thought you saw suthin," said Collinson tentatively. "Nonsense," said Key hurriedly. "We really saw nothing. It was all a fancy, and Uncle Dick was joking me because I said I thought I saw a woman's face," he added with a forced laugh. Collinson glanced at him, half sadly. "Oh. You were only funnin', then. I oughter guessed that. I oughter have noted from Uncle Dick's talk." They rode for some moments in silence, Key preoccupied and feverish, and eager only to reach Skinner's. Skinner was not only postmaster but registrar of the district, and the new discoverer did not feel entirely safe until he had put his formal notification and claims on record. This was no publication of his actual secret, nor any indication of success, but was only a record that would in all probability remain unnoticed and unchallenged amidst the many other hopeful dreams of sanguine prospectors. But he was suddenly startled from his preoccupation. "Ye said ye were straightening up your pack just now," said Collinson slowly. "Yes," said Key almost angrily, "and I was. Ye didn't stop to straighten it up down at the forks of the trail, did ye?" "I may have," said Key nervously. "But why? Ye won't mind my axin' ye another question, will ye? Ye ain't carrying round with ye no woman's shoe." Key felt the blood drop from his cheeks. "What do you mean?" he stammered, scarcely daring to lift his conscious eyelids to his companion's glance. But when he did so, he was amazed to find that Collinson's face was almost as much disturbed as his own. "I know it ain't the square thing to ask ye, but this is how it is," said Collinson hesitatingly. "Ye see, just down by the fork of the trail where you came, I picked up a woman's shoe. It sorter got me. For I says to myself, there ain't no one been by my shanty, comin' or goin', for weeks but you boys, and that shoe, from the looks of it, ain't been there as many hours. I knew there wasn't any Wyman hereabouts. I reckoned it couldn't HEV been dropped by Uncle Dick or that other man, for you would have seen it on the road. So I allowed it might have been you. And here it is. He slowly drew from his pocket what key was fully prepared to see the mate of the slipper key had in his saddlebags. The fair fugitive had evidently lost them both. But Key was better prepared now, perhaps this kind of dissimulation is progressive, and quickly alive to the necessity of throwing Collinson off this unexpected scent. And his companion's own suggestion was right to his hand, and, as it seemed, again quite providential. He laughed, with a quick color, which, however, appeared to help his lie, as he replied half hysterically, "You're right, old man, I own up, it's mine. It's DD silly, I know, but then, we're all fools where women are concerned, and I wouldn't have lost that slipper for a mint of money." He held out his hand gaily, but Collinson retained the slipper while he gravely examined it. "You wouldn't mind telling me where you muffed HEV got that," he said meditatively. "Of course I should mind," said Key with a well-affected mingling of mirth and indignation. "What are you thinking of, you old rascal? What do you take me for?" But Collinson did not laugh. "You wouldn't mind giving me the size and shape and general heft of her as wore that shoe?" "Most decidedly I should do nothing of the kind," said Key half impatiently. "Enough, that it was given to me by a very pretty girl. There. That's all you will know." "Given to you," said Collinson, lifting his eyes. "Yes," returned Key sharply. Collinson handed him the slipper gravely. "I only asked you," he said slowly, but with a certain quiet dignity which Key had never before seen in his face, "because thar was suthin' about the size and shape and fillin' out o' that shoe that kinder reminded me of someone, but that someone her as muffed HEV stood up in that shoe ain't o' that kind as would ever stand in the shoes of her as you know at all." The rebuke, if such were intended, lay quite as much in the utter ignoring of Key's airy gallantry and levity as in any conscious slur upon the fair fame of his invented Dulcinea. Yet Key oddly felt a strong inclination to resent the aspersion as well as Collinson's gratuitous morality, and with a mean recollection of Uncle Dick's last evening's scandalous gossip, he said sarcastically, "And, of course, that someone you were thinking of was your lawful wife." "It wore," said Collinson gravely. Perhaps it was something in Collinson's manner, or his own preoccupation, but he did not pursue the subject, and the conversation lagged. They were nearing, too, the outer edge of the present conflagration, and the smoke, lying low in the unburnt woods, or creeping like an actual exhalation of the soil, blinded them so that at times they lost the trail completely. At other times, from the intense heat, it seemed as if they were momentarily impinging upon the burning area, or were being caught in a closing circle. It was remarkable that with his sudden accession of fortune Key seemed to lose his usual frank and careless fearlessness, and impatiently questioned his companion's woodcraft. There were intervals when he regretted his haste to reach Skinner's by this shorter cut, and began to bitterly attribute it to his desire to serve Collinson. Ah, yes. It would be fine indeed, if just as he were about to clutch the prize he should be sacrificed through the ignorance and stupidity of this heavy-handed moralist at his side. But it was not until, through that moralist's guidance, they climbed a steep acclivity to a second ridge, and were comparatively safe, that he began to feel ashamed of his surly silence or surlier interruptions. And Collinson, either through his unconquerable patience, or possibly in a fit of his usual uxorious abstraction, appeared to take no notice of it. A sloping tableland of weather-beaten boulders now effectually separated them from the fire on the lower ridge. They presently began to descend on the further side of the crest, and at last dropped upon a wagon road, and the first track of wheels that Key had seen for a fortnight. Rude as it was, it seemed to him the highway to fortune, for he knew that it passed Skinner's and then joined the great stage road to Marysville, now his ultimate destination. A few rods further on they came in view of Skinner's, lying like a dingy forgotten winter snowdrift on the mountain shelf. It contained a post office, tavern, blacksmith's shop, general store, and express office, scarcely a dozen buildings in all, but all differing from Collinson's mill in some vague suggestion of vitality, as if the daily regular pulse of civilization still beat, albeit languidly, in that remote extremity. There was anticipation and accomplishment twice a day, and as Key and Collinson rode up to the express office, the express wagon was standing before the door ready to start to meet the stagecoach at the crossroads 3 miles away. This again seemed a special providence to Key. He had a brief official communication with Skinner as registrar, and duly recorded his claim. He had a hasty and confidential aside with Skinner as general storekeeper, and such was the unconscious magnetism developed by this embryo millionaire that Skinner extended the necessary credit to Collinson on Key's word alone. That done, he rejoined Collinson in high spirits with the news, adding cheerfully, "And I dare say, if you want any further advances, Skinner will give them to you on Parker's draft." "You mean that bit o' paper that chap left?" said Collinson gravely. "Yes. I tore it up."
"You tore it up," ejaculated Key. "You hear me?"
"Yes," said Collinson. Key stared at him. Surely it was again providential that he had not introduced his secret to this utterly ignorant and prejudiced man. The slight twinges of conscience that his lie about the slippers had caused him disappeared at once. He could not have trusted him even in that. It would have been like this stupid fanatic to have prevented Key's preemption of that claim, until he, Collinson, had satisfied himself of the whereabouts of the missing proprietor. Was he quite sure that Collinson would not revisit the spot when he had gone? But he was ready for the emergency. He had intended to leave his horse with Skinner as security for Collinson's provisions, but Skinner's liberality had made this unnecessary, and he now offered it to Collinson to use and keep for him until called for. This would enable his companion to pack his goods on the mule, and oblige him to return to the mill by the wagon road and outside trail, as more commodious for the two animals. "Ya ain't afeard o' the road agents," suggested a bystander. "They just swarm on Galloper's Ridge, and they held up the downstage only last week. They're not so lively since the deputy sheriff's got a new idea about them, and has been lying low in the brush near Bald Top," returned Skinner. "Anyhow, they don't stop teams nor packs unless there's a chance of their getting some fancy horse flesh by it, and I reckon there ain't much to tempt them there," he added, with a satirical side glance at his customer's cattle. But Key was already standing in the express wagon, giving a farewell shake to his patient companion's hand, and this ingenuous pleasantry passed unnoticed. Nevertheless, as the express wagon rolled away, his active fancy began to consider this new danger that might threaten the hidden wealth of his claim. But he reflected that for a time, at least, only the crude ore would be taken out and shipped to Marysville in a shape that offered no profit to the highwayman. Had it been a gold mine, but here again was the interposition of Providence. A week later, Preble Key returned to Skinner's with a foreman and 10 men, and an unlimited credit to draw upon at Marysville. Expeditions of this kind created no surprise at Skinner's. Parties had before this entered the wilderness gaily, none knew where or what for. The sedate and silent woods had kept their secret while there, they had evaporated, none knew when or where often, alas. With an unpaid account at Skinner's. Consequently, there was nothing in Key's party to challenge curiosity. In another week of rambling, one-storied shed of pine logs occupied the site of the mysterious ruins, and contained the party. In 2 weeks excavations had been made, and the whole face of the outcrop was exposed. In 3 weeks every vestige of former tenancy which the fire had not consumed was trampled out by the alien feet of these toilers of the Sylvan Silver Hollow Company. None of Key's former companions would have recognized the hollow in its blackened leveling and rocky foundation. Even Collinson would not have remembered this stripped and splintered rock, with its heaps of fresh debris, as the place where he had overtaken Key. And Key himself had forgotten, in his triumph, everything but the chance experiment that had led to his success. Perhaps it was well, therefore, that one night, when the darkness had mercifully fallen upon the scene of Sylvan desolation, and its still more incongruous and unsavory human restoration,
and the low murmur of the pines occasionally swelled up from the unscathed mountainside, a loud shout and the trampling of horses' feet awoke the dwellers in the shanty. Springing to their feet, they hurriedly seized their weapons and rushed out, only to be confronted by a dark, motionless ring of horsemen, two flaming torches of pine knots, and a low but distinct voice of authority. In their excitement, half-awakened suspicion and confusion, they were affected by its note of calm preparation and conscious power. "Drop those guns, hold up your hands. We've got every man of you covered." Key was no coward, the men, though flustered, were not cravens, but they obeyed. "Trot out your leader. Let him stand out there, clear, beside that torch." One of the gleaming pine knots disengaged itself from the dark circle and moved to the center, as Preble Key, cool and confident, stepped beside it. "That will do," said the immutable voice. "Now, we want Jack Riggs, Sidney Jack, French Pete, and One-Eyed Charlie." A vivid reminiscence of the former night scene in the hollow of his own and his companions' voices raised in the darkness flashed across Key. With an instinctive premonition that this invasion had something to do with the former tenant, he said calmly, "Who wants them?" "The state of California," said the voice. "The state of California must look further," returned Key in his old pleasant voice, "there are no such names among my party." "Who are you?" "The manager of the Sylvan Silver Hollow Company, and these are my workmen." There was a hurried movement, and the sound of whispering in the hitherto dark and silent circle, and then the voice rose again. "You have the papers to prove that?" "Yes, in the cabin." "And you?" "I've a warrant to the sheriff of Sierra." There was a pause, and the voice went on less confidently. "How long have you been here?"
"3 weeks.
I came here the day of the fire and took up this claim. There was no other house here. There were ruins, you can see them still. It may have been a burnt-up cabin." The voice disengaged itself from the vague background and came slowly forwards. It was a den of thieves. It was the hiding place of Jack Riggs and his gang of road agents. "I've been hunting this spot for 3 weeks. And now the whole thing's up." There was a laugh from Key's men, but it was checked as the owner of the voice slowly ranged up beside the burning torch and they saw his face. It was dark and set with the defeat of a brave man. "Won't you come in and take something?" said Key kindly.
"No.
It's enough fool work for me to have rooted ye out already. But I suppose it's all in my DD day's work. Good night. Forward there. Get." The two torches danced forwards, with the trailing off of vague shadows in dim procession. There was a clatter over the rocks and they were gone. Then, as Preble Key gazed after them, he felt that with them had passed the only shadow that lay upon his great fortune, and with the last tenant of the hollow a proscribed outlaw and fugitive, he was henceforth forever safe in his claim and his discovery. And yet, oddly enough, at that moment, as he turned away, for the first time in 3 weeks there passed before his fancy with a stirring of reproach a vision of the face that he had seen at the window. Chapter 3. Of the great discovery in Sylvan Silver Hollow it would seem that Collinson as yet knew nothing. In spite of Key's fears that he might stray there on his return from Skinner's, he did not, nor did he afterwards revisit the locality. Neither the news of the registry of the claim nor the arrival of Key's workmen ever reached him. The few travelers who passed his mill came from the valley to cross the divide on their way to Skinner's, and returned by the longer but easier detour of the stage road over Galloper's Ridge. He had no chance to participate in the prosperity that flowed from the opening of the mine, which plentifully besprinkled Skinner's settlement. He was too far away to profit even by the chance custom of Key's Sabbath wandering workmen. His isolation from civilization, for those who came to him from the valley were rude Western emigrants like himself, remained undisturbed. The return of the prospecting party to his humble hospitality that night had been an exceptional case. In his characteristic simplicity he did not dream that it was because they had nowhere else to go in their penniless condition. It was an incident to be pleasantly remembered, but whose non-recurrence did not disturb his infinite patience. His pork barrel and flour sack had been replenished for other travelers, His own wants were few. It was a day or two after the midnight visit of the sheriff to Silver Hollow that Key galloped down the steep grade to Collinson's. He was amused, albeit, in his new importance, a little aggrieved also, to find that Collinson had as usual confounded his descent with that of the generally detached Boulder, and that he was obliged to add his voice to the general uproar. This brought Collinson to his door. "I've had your hoss hobbled out among the chickweed and clover in the green pasture back o' the mill, and he's picked up that much that he's looking fat and sassy," he said quietly, beginning to mechanically unstrap Key's bridle, even while his guest was in the act of dismounting. "His back's quite healed up." Key could not restrain a shrug of impatience. It was 3 weeks since they had met, 3 weeks crammed with excitement, energy, achievement, and fortune to Key, and yet this place and this man were as stupidly unchanged as when he had left them. A momentary fancy that this was the reality, that he himself was only awakening from some delusive dream, came over him. But Collinson's next words were practical. "I reckoned that maybe you'd write from Marysville to Skinner to send for the hoss, and forward him to ye, for I never calculated you'd come back." It was quite plain from this that Collinson had heard nothing. But it was also awkward, as Key would now have to tell the whole story, and reveal the fact that he had been really experimenting when Collinson overtook him in the hollow. He evaded this by post-dating his discovery of the richness of the ore until he had reached Marysville. But he found some difficulty in recounting his good fortune. He was naturally no boaster, he had no desire to impress Collinson with his penetration, nor the undaunted energy he had displayed in getting up his company and opening the mine, so that he was actually embarrassed by his own understatement, and under the grave, patient eyes of his companion, told his story at best lamely. Collinson's face betrayed neither profound interest nor the slightest resentment. When Key had ended his awkward recital, Collinson said slowly, "Then Uncle Dick and that other Parker feller ain't got no show in this here find." "No," said Key quickly. "Don't you remember we broke up our partnership that morning and went off our own ways? You don't suppose," he added with a forced half-laugh, "that if Uncle Dick or Parker had struck a lead after they left me, they'd have put me in it?" "Wouldn't they?" asked Collinson gravely. "Of course not." He laughed a little more naturally, but presently added, with an uneasy smile, "What makes you think they would?" "Nothing," said Collinson promptly. Nevertheless, when they were seated before the fire, with glasses in their hands, Collinson returned patiently to the subject. "You was saying they went their way, and you went yours. But your way was back on the old way that you'd all gone together." But Key felt himself on firmer ground here, and answered deliberately and truthfully, "Yes, but I only went back to the hollow to satisfy myself if there really was any house there, and if there was, to warn the occupants of the approaching fire." "And there was a house there," said Collinson thoughtfully. "Only the ruins." He stopped and flushed quickly, for he remembered that he had denied its existence at their former meeting. "That is," he went on hurriedly, "I found out from the sheriff, you know, that there had been a house there. But," he added, reverting to his stronger position, "my going back there was an accident, and my picking up the outcrop was an accident, and had no more to do with our partnership prospecting than you had. In fact," he said, with a reassuring laugh, "you'd have had a better right to share in my claim, coming there as you did at that moment, than they. Why, if I'd have known what the thing was worth, I might have put you in, only it wanted capital and some experience." He was glad that he had pitched upon that excuse, it had only just occurred to him, and glanced affably at Collinson. But that gentleman said soberly, "No, you wouldn't nuther." "Why not?" said Key half angrily. Collinson paused. After a moment he said, "Cos I wouldn't HEV took anything outer that place." Key felt relieved. From what he knew of Collinson's vagaries, he believed him. He was wise in not admitting him to his confidences at the beginning. He might have thought it his duty to tell others. "I'm not so particular," he returned laughingly, "but the silver in that hole was never touched, nor I dare say even imagined by mortal man before. However, there is something else about the hollow that I want to tell you. You remember the slipper that you picked up?
Yes.
Well, I lied to you about that, I never dropped it. On the contrary, I had picked up the mate of it very near where you found yours, and I wanted to know to whom it belonged. For I don't mind telling you now, Collinson, that I believe there was a woman in that house, and the same woman whose face I saw at the window. You remember how the boys joked me about it? Well, perhaps I didn't care that you should laugh at me too, but I've had a sore conscience over my lie, for I remembered that you seemed to have some interest in the matter too, and I thought that maybe I might have thrown you off the scent. It seemed to me that if you had any idea who it was, we might now talk the matter over and compare notes. I think you said, at least, I gathered the idea from a remark of yours, he added hastily, as he remembered that the suggestion was his own, and a satirical one, that it reminded you of your wife's slipper. Of course, as your wife is dead, that would offer no clue, and can only be a chance resemblance, unless he stopped. Have you got them yet?
Yes, both.
He took them from the pocket of his riding jacket. As Collinson received them, his face took upon itself an even graver expression. It's mighty cur us, he said reflectively, but looking at the two of em, the likeness is more fetchin'. Yes, see, my wife had a straight foot, and never wore reglar rights and lefts like other women, but kinder changed about. Yes, see, these shoes is reglar rights and lefts, but never was worn as such. There may be other women as peculiar, suggested Key.
There must be, said Collinson quietly.
For an instant Key was touched with the manly security of the reply, for, remembering Uncle Dick's scandal, it had occurred to him that the unknown tenant of the robber's den might be Collinson's wife. He was glad to be relieved on that point, and went on more confidently. So, you see, this woman was undoubtedly in that house on the night of the fire. She escaped, and in a mighty hurry too, for she had not time to change her slippers for shoes. She escaped on horseback, for that is how she lost them. Now what was she doing there with those rascals, for the face I saw looked as innocent as a saint's. Seemed to yes sort au contrary, just as I reckoned my wife's foot would have looked in a slipper that you said was give to ye, suggested Collinson pointedly, but with no implication of reproach in his voice.
Yes, said Key impatiently.
I've read yarns afore now about them Italian brigands stealin' women, said Collinson reflectively, but that ain't California road agent style.
Great Scott!
If one even so much as spoke to a woman, they'd have been wiped outer the state long ago.
No.
The woman as was there came there to stay. As Key's face did not seem to express either assent or satisfaction at this last statement, Collinson, after a glance at it, went on with a somewhat gentler gravity, I see what's troublin' you, Mr. Key, you've been thinking that mebbe that poor woman might have been the better for a bit o' that fortin' that you discovered under the very spot where them slippers of hers had often trod. You're thinking that mebbe it might have turned her and those men from their evil ways. Mr. Key had been thinking nothing of the kind, but for some obscure reason the skeptical jeer that had risen to his lips remained unsaid. He rose impatiently.
Well, there seems to be no chance of discovering anything now, the house is burnt, the gang dispersed, and she has probably gone with them.
He paused, and then laid three or four large gold pieces on the table. It's for that old bill of our party, Collinson, he said. I'll settle and collect from each. Sometime when you come over to the mine, and I hope you'll give us a call, you can bring the horse. Meanwhile you can use him, you'll find he's a little quicker than the mule. How is business? He added, with a perfunctory glance around the vacant room and dusty bar.
Dar ain't much passin' this way, said Collinson with equal carelessness, as he gathered up the money, except those boys from the valley, and they're most always strapped when they come here.
Key smiled as he observed that Collinson offered him no receipt, and, moreover, as he remembered that he had only Collinson's word for the destruction of Parker's draft. But he merely glanced at his unconscious host, and said nothing.
After a pause he returned in a lighter tone, I suppose you are rather out of the world here.
Indeed, I had an idea at first of buying out your mill, Collinson, and putting in steam power to get out timber for our new buildings, but you see you are so far away from the wagon road, that we couldn't haul the timber away. That was the trouble, or I'd have made you a fair offer.
I don't reckon to ever sell the mill, said Collinson simply. Then observing the look of suspicion in his companion's face, he added gravely, you see, I rigged up the whole thing when I expected my wife out from the States, and I cock a lottie to keep it in memory of her.
He slightly lifted his brows.
But you never told us, by the way, how you ever came to put up a mill here with such an uncertain water supply.
It wasn't uncertain when I came here, Mr. Key, it was a full-fed stream straight from them snow peaks.
It was the earthquake did it?
The earthquake, repeated Key.
Yes.
If the earthquake can heave up that silver-bearing rock that you told us about the first day you came here, and that you found tea other day, it could play roots with a mere millstream, I reckon.
But the convulsion I spoke of happened ages on ages ago, when this whole mountain range was being fashioned, said Key with a laugh.
Well, this year earthquake was 10 years ago, just after I came.
I reckon I ought to remember it.
It was a queer sort o' day in the fall, dry and hot as if thar might have been a fire in the woods, only thar wasn't no wind.
Not a breath of air anywhere.
The leaves of them alders hung straight as a plumb line.
Except for that thar stream and that thar wheel, nothing moved.
Thar wasn't a bird on the wing over that canyon, thar wasn't a squirrel skirmishin' in the hull wood, even the lizards in the rock stiffened like stone Chinese idols.
It kept getting quieter and quieter, until I walked out on that ledge and felt as if I'd have to give a yell just to hear my own voice.
Thar was a thin veil over everything, and betwixt and between everything, and the sun was rooted in the middle of it as if it couldn't move neither.
Everything seemed to be waitin'.
Then all of a sudden suthin' seemed to give some war.
Suthin' fetched away with a queer sort of rumblin', as if the peg had slipped outer creation.
I looked up and calculated to see half a dozen of them boulders come, lickety switch, down the grade.
But, darn my skin, if one of em stirred, and yet while I was looking, the whole face o' that bluff bowed over softly, as if saying goodbye, and got clean away some more before I knowed it.
Why, you see that pile age in the side o' the canyon.
Well, 1,000 feet under that there's trees, 300 feet high, still upright, and standin'.
You know how them pines over on that far mountainside always seem to be climbin' up, over each other's heads to the very top.
Well, Mr. Key, I saw em climbin'.
And when I pulled myself together and got back to the mill, everything was quiet, and, by GD, so was the mill wheel, and there wasn't 2 inches of water in the river.
And what did you think of it? Said Key, interested in spite of his impatience.
I thought, Mr. Key, no.
I mustn't say I thought, for I knowed it.
I knowed that suthin' had happened to my wife.
Key did not smile, but even felt a faint superstitious thrill as he gazed at him.
After a pause Collinson resumed, I heard a month after that she had died about that time o' yaller fever in Texas with the party she was comin' with. Her folks wrote that they died like flies, and was all buried together, unbeknownst and promiscuous, and thar wasn't no remains.
She slipped away from me like that bluff over that canyon, and that was the end of it.
But she might have escaped, said Key quickly, forgetting himself in his eagerness.
But Collinson only shook his head.
Then she'd have been here, he said gravely.
Key moved towards the door still abstractedly, held out his hand, shook that of his companion warmly, and then, saddling his horse himself, departed.
A sense of disappointment in which a vague dissatisfaction with himself was mingled was all that had come of his interview.
He took himself severely to task for following his romantic quest so far.
It was unworthy of the president of the Sylvan Silver Hollow Company, and he was not quite sure but that his confidences with Collinson might have imperiled even the interests of the company. To atone for this momentary aberration, and correct his dismal fancies, he resolved to attend to some business at Skinner's before returning, and branched off on a long detour that would intersect the travelled stage road. But here a singular incident overtook him. As he wheeled into the turnpike, he heard the trampling hoofbeats and jingling harness of the oncoming coach behind him. He had barely time to draw up against the bank before the six galloping horses and swinging vehicle swept heavily by. He had a quick impression of the heat and steam of sweating horse hide, the reek of varnish and leather, and the momentary vision of a female face silhouetted against the glass window of the coach. But even in that flash of perception he recognized the profile that he had seen at the window of the mysterious hut. He halted for an instant, dazed and bewildered in the dust of the departing wheels. Then, as the bulk of the vehicle reappeared, already narrowing in the distance, without a second thought he dashed after it. His disappointment, his self-criticism, his practical resolutions were forgotten. He had but one idea now: the vision was providential. The clue to the mystery was before him, he must follow it. Yet he had sense enough to realize that the coach would not stop to take up a passenger between stations, and that the next station was the one 3 miles below Skinner's. It would not be difficult to reach this by a cut-off in time, and although the vehicle had appeared to be crowded, he could no doubt obtain a seat on top. His eager curiosity, however, led him to put spurs to his horse, and range up alongside of the coach as if passing it, while he examined the stranger more closely. Her face was bent listlessly over a book. There was unmistakably the same profile that he had seen, but the full face was different in outline and expression. A strange sense of disappointment that was almost a revulsion of feeling came over him. He lingered, he glanced again. She was certainly a very pretty woman. There was the beautifully rounded chin, the short straight nose, and delicately curved upper lip, that he had seen in the profile, and yet it was not the same face he had dreamt of. With an odd, provoking sense of disillusion, he swept ahead of the coach, and again slackened his speed to let it pass. This time the fair unknown raised her long lashes and gazed suddenly at this persistent horseman at her side, and an odd expression, it seemed to him almost a glance of recognition and expectation, came into her dark, languid eyes. The pupils concentrated upon him with a singular significance, that was almost, he even thought, a reply to his glance, and yet it was as utterly unintelligible. A moment later, however, it was explained. He had fallen slightly behind in a new confusion of hesitation, wonder, and embarrassment, when from a wooded trail to the right, another horseman suddenly swept into the road before him. He was a powerfully built man, mounted on a thoroughbred horse of a quality far superior to the ordinary roadster. Without looking at Key, he easily ranged up beside the coach as if to pass it, but Key, with a sudden resolution, put spurs to his own horse and ranged also abreast of him, in time to see his fair unknown start at the apparition of this second horseman and unmistakably convey some signal to him, a signal that to Key's fancy now betrayed some warning of himself. He was the more convinced as the stranger, after continuing a few paces ahead of the coach, allowed it to pass him at a curve of the road, and slackened his pace to permit Key to do the same. Instinctively conscious that the stranger's object was to scrutinize or identify him, he determined to take the initiative, and fixed his eyes upon him as they approached. But the stranger, who wore a loose brown linen duster over clothes that appeared to be superior in fashion and material, also had part of his face and head draped by a white silk handkerchief worn under his hat, ostensibly to keep the sun and dust from his head and neck, and had the advantage of him. He only caught the flash of a pair of steel-gray eyes, as the newcomer, apparently having satisfied himself, gave rein to his spirited steed and easily repassed the coach, disappearing in a cloud of dust before it. But Key had by this time reached the cut-off, which the stranger, if he intended to follow the coach, either disdained or was ignorant of, and he urged his horse to its utmost speed. Even with the stranger's advantages, it would be a close race to the station. Nevertheless, as he dashed on, he was by no means insensible to the somewhat quixotic nature of his undertaking. If he was right in his suspicion that a signal had been given by the lady to the stranger, it was exceedingly probable that he had discovered not only the fair inmate of the robber's den, but one of the gang itself, or at least a confederate and ally. Yet far from deterring him, in that ingenious sophistry with which he was apt to treat his romance, he now looked upon his adventure as a practical pursuit in the interests of law and justice. It was true that it was said that the band of road agents had been dispersed, it was a fact that there had been no spoliation of coach or teams for 3 weeks, but none of the depredators had ever been caught, and their booty, which was considerable, was known to be still intact. It was to the interest of the mine, his partners, and his workmen that this clue to a danger which threatened the locality should be followed to the end. As to the lady, in spite of the disappointment that still rankled in his breast, he could be magnanimous. She might be the paramour of the strange horseman, she might be only escaping from some hateful companionship by his aid. And yet one thing puzzled him, she was evidently not acquainted with the personality of the active gang, for she had, without doubt, at first mistaken him for one of them, and after recognizing her real accomplice had communicated her mistake to him. It was a great relief to him when the rough and tangled cut off at last broadened and lightened into the turnpike road again, and he beheld, scarcely a quarter of a mile before him, the dust cloud that overhung the coach as it drew up at the lonely wayside station. He was in time, for he knew that the horses were changed there, but a sudden fear that the fair unknown might alight, or take some other conveyance, made him still spur his jaded steed forward. As he neared the station he glanced eagerly around for the other horseman, but he was nowhere to be seen. He had evidently either abandoned the chase or ridden ahead. It seemed equally a part of what he believed was a providential intercession, that on arriving at the station he found there was a vacant seat inside the coach. It was diagonally opposite that occupied by the lady, and he was thus enabled to study her face as it was bent over her book, whose pages, however, she scarcely turned. After her first casual glance of curiosity at the new passenger, she seemed to take no more notice of him, and he began to wonder if he had not mistaken her previous interrogating look. Nor was it his only disturbing query. He was conscious of the same disappointment now that he could examine her face more attentively, as in his first cursory glance. She was certainly handsome, if there was no longer the freshness of youth, there was still the indefinable charm of the woman of 30, and with it the delicate curves of matured muliebrity and repose. There were lines, particularly around the mouth and fringed eyelids, that were deepened as by pain, and the chin, even in its rounded fullness, had the angle of determination. From what was visible, below the brown linen duster that she wore, she appeared to be tastefully although not richly dressed. As the coach at last drove away from the station, a grizzled, farmer-looking man seated beside her uttered a sigh of relief, so palpable as to attract the general attention. Turning to his fair neighbor with a smile of uncouth but good-humored apology, he said in explanation, "You'll excuse me, miss. I don't know exactly how you're feelin', for judging from your looks and general gait, you're a stranger in these parts, but easy for me, I don't mind sayin' that I never feel exactly safe from these your road agents and stage robbers until arter we pass Skinner's station. All along that Galloper's Ridge it's jest tech and go like, the woods is swarmin' with them. But once past Skinner's, you're all right. They never dare go below that. So if you don't mind, miss, for it's bane in your presence, I'll jest pull off my boots and ease my feet for a spell." Neither the inconsequence of this singular request, nor the smile it evoked on the faces of the other passengers, seemed to disturb the lady's abstraction. Scarcely lifting her eyes from her book, she bowed a grave assent. "You see, miss," he continued, "and you gents," he added, taking the whole coach into his confidence, "I've got over 40 ounces of clean gold dust in them buttes, between the upper and lower sole, and it's mighty tight packing for my feet. Ye kin heft it," he said, as he removed one boot and held it up before them. "I put the dust there for safety culky Latin that while these road gentry alloys goes for a man's pockets and his body belt, they never thinks of his buttes, or haven't time to go through em." He looked around him with a smile of self-satisfaction. The murmur of admiring comment was, however, broken by a burly bearded miner who sat in the middle seat.
"That's pretty fair, as far as it goes," he said smilingly, "but I reckon it wouldn't go far if you started to run.
I've got a simpler game than that, gentlemen, and easy, we're all friends here, and the danger's over, I don't mind telling yet.
The first thing these road agents do, after they've covered the driver with their shotguns, is to make the passengers get out and hold up their hands.
That, ma'am," explanatorily to the lady, who betrayed only a languid interest, "is to keep them from drawing their revolvers.
A revolver is the last thing a road agent wants, either in a man's hand or in his holster.
So I says to myself, if a six-shooter ain't of no account, what's the use of carrying it?
So I just put my shooting iron in my valise when I travel, and fill my holster with my gold dust, so.
It's a deuced sight heavier than a revolver, but they don't feel its weight, and don't care to come nigh it.
And I've been held up twice on t'other side of the divide this year, and I passed free every time."
The applause that followed this revelation and the exhibition of the holster not only threw the farmer's exploits into the shade, but seemed to excite an emulation among the passengers. Other methods of securing their property were freely discussed, but the excitement culminated in the leaning forward of a passenger who had, up to that moment, maintained a reserve almost equal to the fair unknown. His dress and general appearance were those of a professional man, his voice and manner corroborated the presumption.
"I don't think, gentlemen," he began with a pleasant smile, "that any man of us here would like to be called a coward, but in fighting with an enemy who never attacks, or even appears, except with a deliberately prepared advantage on his side, it is my opinion that a man is not only justified in avoiding an unequal encounter with him, but in circumventing by every means the object of his attack.
You have all been frank in telling your methods.
I will be equally so in telling mine, even if I have perhaps to confess to a little more than you have, for I have not only availed myself of a well-known rule of the robbers who infest these mountains, to exempt all women and children from their spoliation, a rule which, of course, they perfectly understand gives them a sentimental consideration with all Californians, but I have, I confess, also availed myself of the innocent kindness of one of that charming and justly exempted sex."
He paused and bowed courteously to the fair unknown.
"When I entered this coach I had with me a bulky parcel which was manifestly too large for my pockets, yet as evidently too small and too valuable to be interested to the ordinary luggage. Seeing my difficulty, our charming companion opposite, out of the very kindness and innocence of her heart, offered to make a place for it in her satchel, which was not full. I accepted the offer joyfully. When I state to you, gentlemen, that that package contained valuable government bonds to a considerable amount, I do so, not to claim your praise for any originality of my own, but to make this public avowal to our fair fellow passenger for securing to me this most perfect security and immunity from the road agent that has been yet recorded." With his eyes riveted on the lady's face, Key saw a faint color rise to her otherwise impassive face, which might have been called out by the enthusiastic praise that followed the lawyer's confession. But he was painfully conscious of what now seemed to him a monstrous situation. Here was, he believed, the actual accomplice of the road agents calmly receiving the complacent and puerile confessions of the men who were seeking to outwit them. Could he, in ordinary justice to them, to himself, or the mission he conceived he was pursuing, refrain from exposing her, or warning them privately? But was he certain? Was a vague remembrance of a profile momentarily seen and, as he must even now admit, inconsistent with the full face he was gazing at, sufficient for such an accusation? More than that, was the protection she had apparently afforded the lawyer consistent with the function of an accomplice?
"Then if the danger's over," said the lady gently, reaching down to draw her satchel from under the seat, "I suppose I may return it to you."
"By no means. Don't trouble yourself.
Pray allow me to still remain your debtor at least as far as the next station," said the lawyer gallantly. The lady uttered a languid sigh, sank back in her seat, and calmly settled herself to the perusal of her book. Key felt his cheeks beginning to burn with the embarrassment and shame of his evident misconception. and here he was on his way to Marysville, to follow a woman for whom he felt he no longer cared, and for whose pursuit he had no longer the excuse of justice.
"Then I understand that you have twice seen these road agents," said the professional man, turning to the miner.
"Of course, you could be able to identify them."
"Nary a man. You see, they're all masked, and only one of them ever speaks."
"The leader or chief?"
"No, the orator."
"The orator," repeated the professional man in amazement.
"Well, you see, I call him the orator, for he's mighty glib with his tongue, and reels off all he has to say like as if he had it by heart. He's mighty rough on you, too, sometimes, for all his high-toned style. If he thinks a man is hiding anything, he just scalps him with his tongue, and blamed if I don't think he likes the chance of doing it. He's got a regular set speech, and he's bound to go through it all, even if he makes everything wait, and runs the risk of capture. Yet he ain't the chief, and even I've heard folks say ain't got any responsibility if he is took, for he don't take anybody or anybody's money, and couldn't be prosecuted. I reckon he's some sort of a broken-down lawyer, d'ye see.
"Not much of a lawyer, I imagine," said the professional man, smiling, "for he'll find himself quite mistaken as to his share of responsibility. But it's a rather clever way of concealing the identity of the real leader. It's the smartest gang that was ever started in the Sierras. They fooled the sheriff of Sierra the other day. They gave him a sort of idea that they had a kind of hiding place in the woods where they met and kept their booty, and, by jinks, he goes down there with his hull posse just spiling for a fight and only lights upon a gang of innocent greenhorns, who were boring for silver on the very spot where he allowed the robbers had their den. He ain't held up his head since."
Key cast a quick glance at the lady to see the effect of this revelation. But her face, if the same profile he had seen at the window, betrayed neither concern nor curiosity. He let his eyes drop to the smart boot that peeped from below her gown, and the thought of his trying to identify it with the slipper he had picked up seemed to him as ridiculous as his other misconceptions. He sank back gloomily in his seat. By degrees the fatigue and excitement of the day began to mercifully benumb his senses. Twilight had fallen and the talk had ceased. The lady had allowed her book to drop in her lap as the darkness gathered, and had closed her eyes. He closed his own, and slipped away presently into a dream, in which he saw the profile again as he had seen it in the darkness of the hollow, only that this time it changed to a full face, unlike the lady's or anyone he had ever seen. Then the window seemed to open with a rattle, and he again felt the cool odors of the forest, but he awoke to find that the lady had only opened her window for a breath of fresh air. It was nearly 8 o'clock, it would be an hour yet before the coach stopped at the next station for supper. The passengers were drowsily nodding. He closed his eyes and fell into a deeper sleep, from which he awoke with a start. The coach had stopped.